Thanks so much for coming. My name is Gabriel Broadbar. I'm the executive director of the NYU Reynolds Program in Social Entrepreneurship. And I'm really thrilled to be welcoming all of you to the inaugural event of this year's Social Entrepreneurship in the 21st Century Speaker Series. Tonight's event, obviously from the music and the title, The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly of Social Entrepreneurship, actually marks the 10th anniversary of this speaker series. And the two guests that we have here really are the perfect social entrepreneurs that are gonna help us mark the occasion. Nancy Lublin is the founder and self-described chief old person at Do Something, a position she will soon be transitioning away from to take the helm at Crisis Text Line, which is an organization she also founded. Nancy is being interviewed tonight by Jonathan Lewis. Jonathan Lewis is clearly chief, much older person. But more importantly, he is the founder and chair of MCE Capital and the president of the Opportunity Collaboration. And we're really thrilled to have them both with us. They are truly inspiring examples of what social entrepreneurship is really all about. And what they do and how they do it really personifies a lot of the ideals that are near and dear to the NYU Reynolds program. To begin with, they are both deeply values-driven change agents. The social impact that they have helped realize, both domestically and internationally, comes from a recognition that all of us share the responsibility for building a better planet. I think they each lead by example, yet at the same time recognize that leadership is sometimes a team sport, that leading means listening, and leading can often mean getting out of the way and catalyzing others to blaze an even better path. That said, neither of them, I think, is willing to suffer fools gladly. That would disrespect the work, and worse, disrespect the work, the people that the work is supposed to serve. I think each of them lives their missions 24/7, and they really do so in a way with a tremendous amount of purpose and humility. So much so that both of them are probably thinking, "Good Lord, enough with these BS accolades. We're here to talk about the work. So why don't we go ahead and do that?" Tonight's discussion is being billed as a very honest conversation, and as I think we'll soon see, these are two people who are really constitutionally incapable of having anything but a very honest conversation. I hope all of you have brought an open mind and a willingness to participate. Following the event, the conversation, there'll be some time for some Q&A. And then for those of you who are joining us via our simulcast, please tweet your questions using @NYUReynolds or use #NYUSoSent. And with that in mind, please join me in warmly welcoming Nancy and Jonathan.
Thank you. Yeah. From the introduction, I hardly recognize myself. Thanks, Gabe. Much appreciated. So let me set the stage, little pun there, with these comments. So we're going to talk tonight about the general field of social entrepreneurship. As the title suggested, the good, the bad, and in my case, the ugly part of it, trends, challenges, and for that purpose, we are gifted and blessed to have Nancy with us, who really is the living embodiment of what we think about when we talk about social entrepreneurship. But there is a division of labor tonight. Nancy and I are going to cover the larger trends, try and unpack a little bit about what we like and don't like about the field, what's faddish about it, what's rooted and grounded in values. And then the division of labor, though, is you as our co-conversationalists, as the audience, when we get to Q&A, we're depending on you to really drill down much deeper and ask the much tougher, the much harder questions, the stuff we overlook, and including anything you want to know about any of the three organizations which have benefited from Nancy's spectacular leadership. So be thinking of your questions, and we'll get started. So I think what I'd really like to ask you more than anything at this point is, as you've been at this a long time, multiple roles, did a turnaround, started your own organization, now starting your own organization again. You've sat on many, many stages in this field. As you live this thing called social entrepreneurship, what is it to you? What does it mean for you?
I think at its heart, it's an entrepreneur with an aversion to making money. The term social entrepreneur happened after I was one. So I think I was doing this before people knew how to spell entrepreneur. Mm-hmm. It's a very strange little French word. It's really weird now that everybody like wants to be one, and there are programs for one and degrees, and there are people hunched over laptops in Starbucks trying to find with their pumpkin spice latte, trying to find something they can run and something they can start. And I never set out to do this. I was actually a miserable law student here. Anybody in law school? I'm sorry. Yeah. See? Yeah, I'm really sorry.
Wait. Let's leave your hands up for a minute. How many are in law school? And how many of you are miserable?
Oh, the rest are just lying. Right, okay. How many of you are liars? Right. Yeah. The only thing worse than being a lawyer is being a lawyer larvae. Entrepreneurs in law school, that's... Right. Yeah. So I was to quote Lady Gaga, I was like born this way. I was constantly like starting things. No, all of my gay friends are like, you sound like you're gay. Only I like men. But you're born this way. It's like this thing, and that's now become cool, like being gay. So it was not cool for a long time. My parents were like, who's gonna marry her? How is she gonna support herself? Just go to law school. You have a big mouth, which is what you did for women who had opinions in the 80s, they went to law school. And because I wasn't going to be a doctor. I don't like blood. So I went to law school, and then I got here and was like, this is fucking miserable. The font is like 9-point font, and there are these case studies, and everything is, learn it in these really rigid way of thinking. And the whole thing about being an entrepreneur is that you're constantly saying, well, like, why? Why is it that way? Is there a different way to do this? And you're just constantly asking questions. And that's not a good look in law school. So yes. I don't know. The answer to your question that you asked like 5 minutes ago, I don't, apparently being a social entrepreneur means being long-winded. I don't know. So I don't know. All I know is I have been this, and it found me before I found it or before it became cool. And for most of my life, I didn't want to be this. It would have been great to graduate from law school, go to a law firm, earn lots of money and like hang out in the Hamptons on the weekends. Although what I had to discover, and that's really what my 20s were, was that actually I don't like the Hamptons. I like New York when all the people who go to the Hamptons go to the Hamptons. And I like starting new things, and I'm not sure what I would do with all of that money anyway. So. And it's really nice now that there is a community of us, and there is a term for it, I guess, and there are forums like this. It's a little less lonely. It's great. But I do still get weirded out by all these people who are like, I want to start something, and they're not passionate about a thing. They're just passionate about running something. That's weird.
So let's come back to that, but I want to go to the Hamptons for a minute. So if you're at a party, like, I mean, I don't know if you go to parties at the Hamptons, apparently not, but wherever one goes to parties in New York, do you, and people say, what do? Do you actually say, I'm a social entrepreneur?
It depends on the party. So people like me don't ever stop working, and so at a party like that, I mean, I'm there to pick their pockets. Let's be honest, like I'm there to fundraise.
Right.
My family still likes to tell, when I founded Dress for Success, I had a 92-year-old aunt who was on her deathbed, and I figured she couldn't take it with her, so I hit her up for $2,500 in the hospital, which I got, but was not invited to Thanksgiving that year. that was funny, by the way, but a true story. And that's what it means to be a social entrepreneur. Like, you believe in this more than anything. So yeah, I mean, I mean, you mean, do I go out or am I a hermit?
Do you use the phrase social entrepreneur to
sometimes
describe yourself?
Yes.
Does anybody know what the hell you're talking about?
No, not really.
Yeah.
I think actually also in the last 10 years, people think that means, you know, like the hybrid organizations, you know, like Tom's Shoes and and Warby and or the not-for-profit versions that are trying to do double bottom line businesses, which is bullshit. They don't exist. So we were going to do real talk, right?
I'm listening.
Yeah.
That's my job here. That's the role.
I think a lot of people think that's what a social entrepreneur is. I just slapped the word social in front of entrepreneur and I called it a day.
Why is it bullshit? Let's talk about...
There's no such thing as a double bottom line business.
Keep talking. I want to hear more.
This is the thing that makes me nuts. People do this all the time with Do Something, with Crisis Tech Sign. Oh, you should do this also. You should do this to make revenue. Great, so we'd be running two companies. I mean, which is hard. So no, you have one. You work for one maker. There's one primary purpose. And if those two things come in conflict, which would you pick? That's the company you are. If it's profit because you have shareholders or you have investors, you're a for-profit company, and that's your bottom line that you have to shoot for. It's great that you also give stuff away or do really great cause marketing campaigns. That's terrific. So you're a good business, and I will shop there. Awesome. But it's not the same.
In your taxonomy of these things, where do you put the social enterprises who are forming themselves or currently in operation to actually produce a product they think has social benefit? The classic is the mosquito bed nets. Or something, you know, those kinds of things.
Fantastic. If you're a for-profit business that's producing bed nets, those need to be used. You have a huge market out there, unfortunately. You know, if you're producing solar lamps and it's a for-profit company and it's a good business, that's terrific. I mean, there's lots of good businesses out there. I just ate a box of Fig Newtons. I mean, they're not good for me, but I like them. They're a good business. They're never, like, people are always going to eat Fig Newtons. So, you know, there's lots of, like, good businesses out there that doesn't, that's not the same as doing a not-for-profit and being a public good company. It's not the same. And I happen to be kind of evangelical not-for-profit sector. The not-for-profit sector has been pummeled as we need to behave more like businesses. Like which businesses? Like Enron? I actually think there's a whole lot that the for-profit sector could learn from Here. There are for-profit companies. These are things that people will pay money for those goods and services. The markets have determined that there's value there. So we will pay for those things. There's government, things that the state has determined, and in different countries or different states, there's different things that are covered. Some countries cover healthcare more than ours. Some countries cover education more than ours. See, I really did go to law school here. And then there's stuff in the middle, like needle exchange programs, which are never gonna be for-profit companies, and the state is not gonna cover because, unfortunately, people don't care about drug addicts. And so there's stuff in the middle, and it has always been that way in the United States. For 200 years, the not-for-profit sector has been saving the ass of this country, and we ought to be proud about it and kind of roar about it. The not-for-profit sector is vital and needed and may never have, you know, enterprises supporting them and revenue streams supporting them, and it doesn't matter. We should be supporting them anyway because they're valuable, and they help people who aren't necessarily drinking pumpkin spice lattes.
Okay. I want to stick with this just for a second because I think we're really onto something important. How do you see your social change work in the nonprofit sector in relationship to things, power, upsetting the status quo, privilege, the structural things that created the problem in the first place?
I think my thinking on that has really evolved as I've aged and as I've spent more time with other people who make me better.
Mm-hmm.
And as I've become more frustrated in the lack of systems change. So Crisis Tech Sign is what I'm about to be spending all my time on. And so right now we have a corpus of about 8.4 million total text messages that have been exchanged. And we have the volume, velocity, and variety that makes this corpus one of the largest public health data sets in America. So after the NIH and CDC, and it's the only one that's real time, right? Their data sets take ages for researchers and people to pile on. And people said, hey, wow, you should monetize that, right? There's the enterprise as a revenue stream. And instead, we've opened it and made it available to the public. You can go to crisistrends.org right now and see the worst states for suicide, the worst time of day for substance abuse, the worst days of the week for eating disorders. And we thought it was really important to make that open and public because we want to fuel police departments and school boards and journalists and academics to do meaningful work on top of it, because we'd like to inspire policy change and bigger thinking. So that was important to us. It's a whole nother like part of Crisis Text Line, and it's more work, but I really feel like system change is where we have to be. We can't just work with victims and survivors and think that we're going to solve everything. We've got to get to the place where we stop this stuff from happening to begin with.
And circling back then to your thoughts about nonprofit work.
Nonprofit work is most of Silicon Valley. I would think of this as not-for-profit work.
Not-for-profit, we're on the same page, the vocabulary aside.
It's just a dig at Silicon Valley.
Sorry. Yeah, no, I got it. Do you think that these enterprises all need to have an advocacy component where they're interfacing with government and trying to change public policy in order to ultimately get the preventative stuff done?
No, I don't think they all do. I think more of them could. So here's something impressive. Donors Choose. Mm-hmm. I mean, besides Taylor Swift, Donors Choose won 2014, right? Donors Choose is on fire. Donors Choose is amazing. You should all be, funding projects there. Think about the data set Donors Choose has. And so Donors Choose built an API that you can go in and think about what they're sitting on. If all of a sudden teachers are posting more science projects in Oklahoma, maybe that happened because Oklahoma cut back science funding. I mean, you can actually see interesting trends in what's happened with funding in the education space thanks to that. So that would influence policy. Here's another one.
Wait. Yeah. But does it? It sounds to me
like... Well, they've opened it up.
It sounds though more like, in that particular example, the organization is actually infilling or backfilling a failure of government. Oh. It's not actually changing policy.
We're in the middle. Here we are. We are forever in the middle. This is the saving the ass of America comment.
Okay.
Yeah. We are always going to need to be there, but that information can hopefully change the way these other people think. I mean, we need voters to then see that information and hopefully care about education. Here's another example. A woman named Veronica Scott in Detroit has this fantastic organization called the Empowerment Plan. She makes coats for homeless, jackets, that convert into sleeping bags. It's pretty cool. And so that's great. Like, there are lots of organizations that do like nice things for the homeless, soup kitchens and all that. And she said, and people have said to her, you should manufacture that in China. You could sell them on Amazon. It could support your organization. And instead, she said, no, I want them manufactured here in Detroit. I want to teach people how to sew, how to create these jackets, because what's really going to create systems change is jobs. And that's a different way of thinking about things. I think we need more entrepreneurs like her.
Okay. I want to change signals here for a minute. A bunch of of us in this room are looking at social entrepreneurship careers. Tell us how you spend your day. You get up, you brush your teeth, and then I'm hoping. And then what happens here?
I am awoken at 6:30 every day by my son, who likes to snuggle. Mm-hmm. So I am awoken every morning at 6 o'clock, at 6:30, because we've told him he can't come into our room until 6:30. So at exactly 6:30, he throws his body on top of mine and screams, snuggle! That's how I start my day. And then I cajole him into brushing his teeth. He doesn't really like to brush his teeth, which is an interesting story because he's actually an inventor of a quirky product called Squeezy. Anyway, that's just, put a pin in that one. You can go look that up later. Sidebar. And I walk them to school on the High Line. We are the financial aid family at Avenues. Hi. And and then I city bike from there. I'm obsessed with city bike. I'm like Fast and Furious on a bike. And city bike over to the offices at Do Something, where I spend the day doing email and meetings. I would say that 60% of my time is spent on culture and on the people that I work with. some of whom are actually here, and because I think that, especially in the not-for-profit sector, that is your asset. People are your asset. And people talk about that a lot, but like, what does it actually mean? And nurturing talent and getting people to be happy and productive and work with each other is my favorite part of my job and the thing that I spend most of my time doing. Yeah, and then I'll like scarf down food in a few minutes, or I'll have a lunch meeting, and then there's always not-for-profit type events at night, and then I go home and kiss my kids, put them to bed, and then I'll work again on my computer from about 8 until midnight.
Wow.
And by the way, you know what's funny about that? A couple of years ago, I didn't have a home computer. There was something weird about it where I was like fine buying shoes, but I thought that somehow buying a computer for myself was too extravagant, and instead I should spend my money like on my kids or on other stuff. And about 2 years ago now, I finally bought myself a laptop at home, and I'm so much more productive, and I love it because I love to work, but mm-hmm. I definitely work every night between about 8 and midnight, sometimes until more like 1. I don't sleep that much. Mm-hmm. Notice the real thing missing is exercise. Yeah. I don't know. I just sort of gave that up.
And obviously, you know, you have lots of data points of other, quote, social entrepreneurs that you spend time with. Do you think you're fairly typical in terms of the long hours and the non-exercise program? And
oh, I know I am. We email each other late at night.
Yeah.
Several of them. There are a few, actually. I went through a period of time where I liked really hiring runners. I thought there was something really great about runners. Anybody here a runner? Yeah, it was really awesome to hire, especially long-distance runners, because I thought, you're really crazy. Like, I understood, like, running to, like, kick a ball or running, I don't know, because, like, a coach was being like, you have to run if you're going to be on this team. But, like, people who just run and challenge themselves, you're so disciplined. Why do you do that? So I really liked hiring them for a while. That worked out really well. A lot of runners also write code. They're very like disciplined and in their own head. That was good.
I wouldn't know. I'm in the no exercise program. You would never hire me. So I want to read you a quote if I could, and ask if you could share with us what it means for you. A quote, never be too proud or too busy to stop and pick up a penny in the rain.
Yeah, that's my personal motto. And so it's really easy to go through life being super busy. I actually came up with that when I was at Dress for Success, that one of the most amazing things to me about Dress for Success was that all of these thousands and thousands of women coming to us who had like a really... They had it hard. Like some of them mm-hmm. had multiple children. Most of them were coming out of a domestic violence situation or a shelter. They never complained. Like they were never like, oh, this is too far. I had to schlep here from an outer borough, or this is hard. They just never whined and complained. Yeah, it's like complaining has become a white girl thing. So like they just never complained. And I decided, why? Like, so I'm not complaining that I don't go to the gym. It's my own fault. If I want to go to the gym, I go to the gym. They just never complained. I learned so much from that. And so I created my own weird personal motto, which was never be too proud or too busy to stop and pick up a penny in the rain. There's value everywhere. And I literally do it, sometimes in like gross puddles and stuff. But there's value in everybody and in everything around us, and nobody in this room is too busy or should be too proud to find value everywhere.
If that's one end of the continuum, do you find it at odds with your, what I sense is a laser focus on whatever you're working on?
No, I'm just very fast. So I'm laser focused, but I also move very quickly from thing to thing. I pivot very quickly in my head. Right now I'm doing both jobs. So I'm mm-hmm. CEO of Do Something and Crisis Tech Sign at the same time, which I don't recommend. Mm-hmm. but it's oddly, it's kind of working, and I pivot between them. There are a few tricks to the trade. How many people here use Slack? Yeah, Slack. Slack is one of the ways that I'm able to do what I do. I would also say that speed and focus, New York City is a working woman's heaven. You can get any body part you want waxed at any hour of night in this town. You can get anything delivered. You can get diapers delivered. You can get food delivered. You can get pick up, you know, laundry and things like that. If I lived anywhere else, I would be carpooling my kids places because, let's be honest, that burden typically falls to the mom. Mm-hmm. And it would be a very different life. There's something really wonderful about being a working woman in New York City. So you're able to focus and you have more time to spend quality time with your kids and also to spend time working.
Do you think that the pivot skill is a non-negotiable skill for social entrepreneurs?
I don't know that that's just for entrepreneurs. I've met a lot of entrepreneurs who are super flaky and are really big vision and moonshots. Gosh, I met one guy today. He's a wild man. And truly, and like one out of 10 things that he has started has hit, but they're like big hits. So he started Red Nose Day, which some of you might know. He started, 3 months ago, talked to the Global Citizen folks, and only in June decided that there should be a text message that went out to like as much of the planet as possible describing the global goals. Did anybody get the text message on Saturday? It went out to 1 billion people. Apparently, not you. But, like, so he made that. Like, he's just a wild thinker, and he's all over the place. There are social entrepreneurs. I would say there to be successful anything in this day and age requires agility, sort of, which is usually partnered with hunger and interest.
Learnable skill. I've been going back to your early description of yourself as you felt like you were born to be a social entrepreneur or an entrepreneur or certainly not a law student. So is this learnable?
You probably learn to fake it. I don't know that it's actually innately learnable. What I'm coming to realize is that we really are hardwired for various things. Some people really love startups. They like the pace. They like the intensity. Some people really like being pushed. And some people don't. And I think, again, like your 20s are about figuring out what do you like? What kind of environment do you thrive in? Not everybody's made for working in a big company. Not everybody's made for working in a small company where you're expected to kind of do a little bit of everything. And you've got to figure out what makes you tick. And one is not better than the other, is the other thing. That's another thing, which is I think that we've got this hierarchy, which is everybody wants to be the CEO, everybody wants to be the founder, even more than CEO. The first thing you say, by the way, when you say you're the CEO of something is the first thing someone says, oh, are you the founder? And if you're not the founder, because I'm not the founder of Do Something, people are incredibly disappointed. Like, where's the founder? I'd like to meet the founder. I mean, he's adorable. You would love to meet the founder. It's Andrew Hsu from Melrose Place, right? Like, he's very sweet, but... So not everybody is made to be the founder, and different people are good at different jobs. One of the interesting things about the modern workplace is when you're good at a job, you get promoted out of it. So you're really good at doing something, and so what happens is you get promoted to be the manager of it, and then you're not doing that job anymore. You're now managing other people to do it. It's really bad in tech organizations, so you're great at writing code, and so you get promoted to manage other people who write code, and then you're not writing code anymore. You're just managing other people to write code. I don't know. The skill sets and the sort of way the modern workplace is set up, it's kind of a bit of a bummer. I think what you need to do is figure out what you're good at and what you like. And if that doesn't mean that you're in charge, that's okay too. We need followers, we need makers, we don't just need CEOs or social entrepreneurs.
So when you're hiring people, I was very impressed or maybe shocked when I read this sentence, this quote from you. Quote, experience is overrated. Somebody else trained that person. He could be stuck in his old ways and expertise can be taught. Passion, however, is invaluable. If passionate people don't have the experience to know something, they make it their business to find out. Passion catalyzes superior performance. And it wasn't something I disagreed with because I actually agree with it a lot, but it But the conventional wisdom is that unleashing passionate people who don't know what they're doing is a formula for disaster. Talk about that.
No, I mean, so you just graduated in May, right? So Mahika, this is her first job. She came to us, and she's full of passion. I would take her over somebody with 20 years experience any day. Somebody with 20 years experience might know how to write a great PowerPoint, and that would be her first instinct, and I would throw up in my mouth a little bit upon looking at the PowerPoint. She doesn't know how to make a PowerPoint. That's awesome. Please don't ever make one, right? Yeah. So I would much rather take super smart whippersnappers who don't say, well, this always been done this way, and instead say, what's the best way to do this? That's a much better question. Experience, I do think, is overrated. So we look for three things when we hire, and these are the three rules that are adapted. DJ Patil wrote, you can find his stuff on Amazon. He's the United States' first chief data scientist. And when he created the data science team at LinkedIn, he used these, and we sort of took them and made them our own. One is, would I want to be in a bunker with you? We're going to spend more time with you than we spend with our family and our friends. So we're really looking for two things. Are you an asshole or are you boring? Because we don't want either one. We want great people. We're going to spend a lot of time with you. So just what are you like as a human? Two, can you hit a home run in 90 days? And we don't ask you that question. We watch you in the interview. I'll walk into the interview midway, and I will just ask a ridiculous question in the middle of you answering something, in the middle of a sentence, and we'll see how flustered you get. And if you're like, that's cool, I can move this quickly, you can hit a home run in 90 days. Like, how do you handle change like that? And then the third one is, you're someone who's capable of doing something amazing in 4 to 6 years. Do you have that amazing thing in you? We don't actually necessarily want you to be a do something or a crisis text line in 4 to 6 years. We'd like you to go do something else, maybe come back, go start something, partner with us, go work somewhere else, partner with us, or just go make the world better in Uganda, whatever. We don't want people who just coast. We want you to come to us, do different jobs. Those are the three things we look for. Notice, I don't really care who your daddy is, and I don't care whether or not you have a college degree. So we no longer require a BA, and I pretty much have no idea where anybody went to school, because it just doesn't really matter.
I like that.
Cool.
My version
is
I always, anyone I'm talking to, I never read their resume before I talk to them, and I always wonder what it'd be like to be stuck with them at an airport, where we're making dinner out of the snack machine, when one of the items won't fall down. How we deal with that is my test for people I like to work with. When you were starting Crisis Text Line, without getting into all the TikTok of, it didn't go well. You were a safe bet, accomplished social entrepreneur. You had worked, you know, this seeming miracle of turning around, dosomething.org, and it was a bummer getting it going. What did you learn from that experience about our space, this thing called starting things and social entrepreneurship and just?
I think I probably learned, I learned three things. One is I learned about myself. Maybe I'm not that good at this. Maybe
this being
this startup thing, like nobody, maybe nobody is so good at this. This is like really easy to do and you can master this. Maybe I got soft, right? Like I have an assistant now. I got old. Maybe I'm not, I do go to sleep at midnight. There used to be a time where I would just work through the night. So I don't know, maybe it was me. Maybe it was my fault that it was so hard. It took 2 years to get Crisis Text Line off the ground. That's what he's referring to. I learned about that mental health and hotline space. It's kind of nasty. I don't know why I was surprised by that. Every space is. My gosh, the breast cancer organizations hate each other. The ASPCA, Humane Society, and PETA are not the best of friends. You know, all of these spaces where you think everybody is buddy-buddy, not so much. It's a bummer, but I had to learn that about this space. And then third, that was, I guess, most dismaying, is that I learned a lot about the foundation space and how hard it is to raise money. It's always hard to raise money. I mean, everybody here has struggled to raise money for something. I assumed it was going to be easy because I had done it before. I knew who to talk to. I had their phone numbers already. And we were kind of triaging it already inside Do Something. So it wasn't like a hypothesis. It was actually happening and it was being piloted. And I went to foundations and said, here's what it is. And they said, oh, this is so great, but you don't fit any of our buckets. Well, new things don't fit old buckets. That's what it means to be new. And it's really hard to get traction behind new stuff. Everybody says they want to hear new things and new solutions in the social change space, but it's really hard to get backing for them and to find partners because it turns out people don't actually like change and they don't really know what to do with new. And that was a bummer. There were some dark days in there. I'm a pretty happy person, so I don't think I was like going through a depression or anything, but there was a lot of evenings of me with Haagen-Dazs coffee ice cream late at night.
Did it work?
The ice cream was great.
Yeah. That's what I'm talking about.
So what happened was I finally raised about $4 million to get it started, convinced a couple of individuals. So the foundations, strung me along for ages and then gave me a much smaller amount of money than I thought I was going to get. So individuals were much kinder. They got it. They can make much faster decisions. So individuals are a better way to go. And then I convinced Ron Johnson, who was at the time CEO of JCPenney, to let us round up at the register in the month of March because it was 2012. And in nickels, dimes, and quarters, Americans shopping at JCPenney gave us $1.3 million.
Nice.
That was pretty great. It was pretty great, and it was also pretty depressing. Like, wow, people shopping at JCPenney totally get this concept, and all they see is like a little flyer at the cash register, and I can't convince the nation's biggest foundations to back this. But like, thank you, America.
So can we go back to the part where you were eating ice cream? I'm very interested. I like coffee. That was the main thing. Was the rejection personal for you? Because it was your idea, or it came out of your sense of what needed to happen, and because you were I remember you got a very wrenching text message from some people that brought you to the space. This was not just a casual thing for you.
No, I mean, crisis text signs, like people bearing their souls to us every day. I mean, it's just really some dark stuff in there. I'm super passionate about it. I mean, it's like my great aunt on her deathbed story. When you really believe in something, you're super, super passionate about it. So the rejection does feel personal. So I will name them. I will tell you, I was strung along by the MacArthur Foundation for a long time. They were going to give us a lot of money. It became less and less. It was a smaller amount of money. And I still said we would agree to launch in Chicago, even though it was a fifth of the money we asked for. I said, you know what, but I'm going to keep the promise, so we'll launch in Chicago. And on the phone, when they told me that it was going to be a fifth of what I thought we were going to get, blah, 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 it was so embarrassing. And one of my colleagues, Liz, was in the room with me on the phone. I couldn't hold back. I started crying. I mean, I'm like, I'm 44 years old. I cry at like the Olympics and ice skating. I don't cry necessarily in like a business meeting. It was awful. And Liz looked at me like, what is going on? I've never seen you like this. And I said on the phone, I was like, because they could hear me. Like, it was like the crying. And I was like, look, I've got to be honest. This is actually, I'm not crying now for Crisis Text Line. I'm going to raise this money. Like, I'm going to raise this money. We're going to launch. We're still going to launch in Chicago. I'm so sad right now because if this is how you've treated me, how are you treating everybody else who's not as experienced, strong, or old as I am? Like, if this is the state of our sector, I'm just really sad. And I'm sorry. And there was just silence on the other end of the phone. And I was like, okay, let's move on. So we moved on to another topic. Now, let me tell you, though, the true part of the story, which I've never told in public, and great, this is being streamed. Hi, MacArthur Foundation. So I sent an email the next day to them saying, I'm really sorry. That was so unprofessional. And that's never happened to me. I'm just really passionate about this. Didn't hear back from them. Took the same email and hand wrote it, stuck it in the mail, didn't hear back from them. About 6 months later, went back to Chicago and had a whole bunch of them in the room, convinced them in the room, told the whole story of crisis text line, which we haven't really done here tonight, but you alluded. There's like some gruesome text. The data is super exciting, and they were all like, this is amazing, like jaws on the floor. And I was like, that's great. While I'm here, I need to tell you a story. Told them the story of what had happened with their colleagues. In the room, they said to me, we are so sorry. It's just been a chaotic time here. We promise we'll be in touch. Sent them a thank you note. Never heard back from any of them. This just keeps happening. The foundation world shits on us. The foundation world, these people, when they leave these foundations, will be shocked to see that they are a lot less popular and have fewer friends when they no longer have somebody else's money behind them. And the saddest thing is that the people named Ford and named MacArthur and named Carnegie, who made all of this money, would be mortified to see how it's being used in their names. They were entrepreneurs with moonshot, big, big, bold ideas, laying railroad tracks where there wasn't anything, creating, you know, unbelievably huge empires and companies, and then had the vision to say, I want to give this all away. And they would be so furious to see how this stuff is being handled in their names, that there are these big, gorgeous buildings that these washed-up PhDs are sitting in, and relenting to give away money and not even showing entrepreneurs the dignity of responding to emails and thank you notes or when someone's in tears. The state of the foundation world in this country, it's really sad. And you're cringing because I'm being honest and I'm saying it. And this is the problem, is that most people, we're not even talking about it. We have to be sycophantic to the people at foundations. And so nothing's changing. And they're sitting on capital that should be released. Do you know that they're fighting regulations? Every year it comes up in Congress to increase the requirement from giving away 5% to giving away 7%. Every year this comes up, and they hire lobbyists and work together to keep that at only 5%. So they're sitting on the corpus, these big fat foundations. They are required only to give away 5%. By the way, the giveaway 5% is not giveaway. It's spend 5%. So a couple of those percentage points are spent on themselves, on their own salaries and their fancy buildings. And then they fight moving that to 7%. Why are they sitting on that money when there are people dying all over the world where we have these huge problems? I will say, and I think you should watch Darren Walker. He's making really big changes over there at the Ford Foundation. I'm a big fan. Watch him. And I say that as someone who is not funded by the Ford Foundation. I'm just a fan, and he knows. I'm watching. And I'm excited. Sell the building, Darren. Sell the building.
So on the assumption, which is probably a fair guess, that our audience is not foundation executives.
But anybody work at a foundation?
Whoa. But might face in their future having to deal with foundation people or others, individual donors or impact investors. What is your counsel on dealing with preparing yourself for rejection and in the social change space?
You know, if I tell you to grow a callus around your heart, you're not going to be any good at your job. You're just going to get a lot of rejections. How many people here have some kind of a startup idea that they're really passionate about and they're struggling to get funded? It's really hard because when someone doesn't believe in your idea, it's like, wait, what do you mean you don't believe in helping babies in Syria? How is this not the most important thing to you right now? It's the most important thing to me right now. What do you mean you don't care about like water in this part of the world or all the issues that you really care? How could you not care about this? It is deeply personal work. And that's one of the reasons I love this sector, because it's full of really passionate people who, and I learn every day from these, from you, from each other. It's a privilege to be part of this third sector, which is why I hate when we get beat up on. We are running organizations that matter, and they're sometimes messy, and it's painful to raise money. And it's so, so important. So please don't stop. I would say to the young people coming into this space, you are choosing a harder path, and it's worth every minute. You're just going to eat a lot of ice cream.
So I have one more question. So those of you who are cogitating on your questions, you know, get ready. I wasn't planning to ask you this, but I can't help myself. I read in your biography that there were... No, it's good. As it turns out, so am I. I read in your biography that there was a period of your life where you were putting together the economics of your activities, and every Friday night you played poker successfully to finance a portion of your income. And after I've spent this last time with you, I don't understand, because I don't play poker, but I heard about a poker face. So how did you win? I don't understand. What the hell were you doing? And what? And you like, you're like one big poker tail, it seems like, to me. Yeah.
I don't do either. Like, I actually love my husband. Like, I'm kind of square. Oh, maybe my only vice is I sometimes steal hair dryers from hotels. But I've decided they're complimentary. If they come in a little bag next to the soap, they're complimentary. Totally different issue.
Does the hotel thing? No,
I've never been charged. They'll charge you for the bathrobes. They don't watch. Anyway.
Hair dryer. Wait, vices are hair dryers, ice cream,
and poker.
Poker.
So I used to play poker in underground. Yeah. So a couple nights a week, with like big fat guys from Staten Island, and it wasn't a good way to go.
Did you learn anything from playing poker that's applicable?
So much.
To the work you do?
So much. I mean, I was there really more to learn than I made money. And then when Giuliani shut down the clubs, I went to Atlantic City by myself for a year and a half every weekend, which is also not a good way to go. You learn a lot playing poker. I recommend everybody playing poker, especially women, if you have a confidence deficit. I'm going to teach you to play poker, Nami. If you really need to like be able to ask for money, if you're not feeling like you could roar, learning how to value your own hand, how to face other people down, patience, being quiet when you should be quiet, playing your position around a table. People think it's just about the cards. It's also about where you sit. I used to hold women's poker nights where I would teach friends how to play. Those are all important lessons. And I really loved cards. But then I started like dreaming about poker. It got to be a bit much. So I stopped cold turkey. I don't play cards at all anymore.
Okay, that's good to know. I am relieved. questions, please, from the audience.
Dimitri Petitsis, program manager here at Reynolds, and real pleasure to have everyone here tonight. This has been a very entertaining as well as enriching moderating session here. So why don't we just give a round of applause to Nancy and Jonathan for all the time and energy here. I'd like to think we have a very self-selected, you know, social entrepreneur in the black and white photos. Those in this audience will be in those photos. And so I want to applaud everyone for coming out tonight. But my first question is, Nancy, we have 200 plus students here in the audience, one of the most expensive schools in the world. Here at NYU, and social entrepreneurship, like you said, is still a up-and-coming space. What advice would you give those students who face financial aid requirements, demands post-graduation, and what resources would you turn them to so they can continue to fight the good fight of social entrepreneurship? Thank you.
The cost of higher education and predatory student lending are something that I hope whoever ends up being our next president will finally really address. It's awful. How many of you are undergraduates? Okay, you all should finish. How many of you are grad students? Why? Truly, I'm gonna encourage as many of you as I can tonight to drop out. The best work is happening outside your classroom. Most important stuff, you're racking up student debt that you may never repay. You're gonna learn faster on the job, unless you're gonna cut somebody open and you're in medical school, or you really know that there's a particular kind of law. It's not worth it. All of the other grad degrees, not worth it. We're not paying you anymore because you have an MSW or M something other. I don't care. I already said, I don't even know where you went to school. And a lot of these people are like me. It just doesn't matter as much anymore as how you present in an interview, how fast you are, that agility thing I talked about before. You're not, the smartest people are not your classmates or the people you're learning from. They're out there doing it. Drop out. I'm happy to talk to as many of you as you like. I will give you my mobile number. Text me. I am happy to talk you through it. I dropped out of this very institution as a law student. And actually, the day that I dropped out, I went right down the street on McDougal Street and I got a tattoo. It's very small and wimpy. It's my heart on my sleeve. And I don't regret the tattoo, and I don't regret dropping out. Okay.
Let's do this side first. Do you mind? Yeah.
Hi, I'm Lauren. Is this working?
Yeah.
I have a question about semantics a little bit. You keep talking about this sector, and you told the story about the lady who was turning coats into sleeping bags. Is not-for-profit and social entrepreneurship to you the same thing? For example, is that business both? It seems like it could be a not-for-profit organization or it could be a social enterprise.
Yeah, it's a not-for-profit. For her, it's a not-for-profit because the thing that she cares about most is jobs in Detroit and the homeless. And I've talked to her about this, and if it was a for-profit company, the thing she would have to care about most would be making money. You owe a duty to your shareholders. You owe a duty to your investors. It is different. And I think businesses that do good things, like I said, are fantastic. That's great. Social enterprises are terrific. But let's just remember that the enterprise is actually more important than the social part. And I just want to make sure that not-for-profits don't get denigrated and lost in this whole thing. In the last 10 years, everybody has so celebrated the social enterprises who are doing good while doing well that I think they've forgotten that there is this middle thing that we should also celebrate and will never go away. We need the not-for-profit sector. It's not better to make money than it is to not make money. They're both needed.
Could you sort of elaborate that on that? Because as you said, there is... I think the dialogue at most events is that social entrepreneurship, the umbrella, includes pure nonprofits doing great work, but also for-profit social ventures that are funded by, quote, impact investors. You think that's just off the reservation?
I think it's lovely to put us all together. I don't have nearly as much in common with them as I do with my, you know, sisters and brothers who are in the not-for-profit space. And I don't really understand why everybody has celebrated the for-profits who are doing this more than the not-for-profits that are doing this. It's very different.
You feel they're being celebrated more. I always thought of it as another way to tap into new money to bring into the space.
Which is, by the way, not happening. There's very little money going to those social enterprises. They're struggling, most of them. There's a few who have made it, but most have not, yep.
I think people are celebrating them more because people are hoping that they're the silver bullet that is going to solve the problems that the not-for-profits haven't been able to solve yet.
Are you working on one?
No.
Okay.
I'm a nonprofit girl. I also want to say city bikes is exercise.
Oh, good, thank you.
Please.
Hi, my name is Maria Paula Robledo. I come from Colombia. I'm a first year MBA. My question is actually for Jonathan. based on your experience, especially on the social impact investing space in Latin America, what do you think about Nancy's comments about how double bottom line purpose enterprises don't really exist?
Okay. Thank you. Yeah, it's a good question. I think I'm going to get some coffee ice cream before I answer you. I'm less enamored with the debate between for-profit and nonprofit, but I'm really strong on whose side you're on. So I think there are some terrific for-profit social ventures, some of them still in the R&D phase, some of them still proving themselves. It's still kind of a new field. I agree with Nancy, most of them are underfunded, and there's this illusion that there's a lot of loose capital floating around. I think that's bullshit. I think it's really hard to raise impact investing capital. But for all of that, I think the people who are working on it are as pure of heart and as clear-headed about their management style and as passionate about the causes and the people they care about. So I'm optimistic that it might lead to something, and I'm willing to put time and energy into it, even though I don't know where it's going. And I totally, 5,000 and 1 million trillion gazillion percent agree with Nancy on the way that I think the nonprofit sector has been cavalierly denigrated. I think it's ridiculous. In large measure, the nonprofit sector is the R&D lab for a lot of the scaled up programs that government adopts, for which they never get royalties. So that's where my head is at on this question. In short, I'm completely confused and deeply committed to coffee ice cream.
Hi, my name is Anne, and I just had a quick question about how do you measure the impact of your work? How do you make sure that you're achieving your mission goals?
This has been the other big question of the last 10 years in the not-for-profit space, right? So Do Something, it's exciting to measure because there are two debates in the sort of volunteer space, which is really what Do Something is. It's a movement of young people tackling things. One is that it's about the people doing it themselves, gaining a sense of efficacy and pride and learning new skills. And the other is that it's the impact they're having on that last mile thing. And at Do Something, we've decided not to weigh in on that debate and instead to decide that both things matter. So we measure both the number of members that we have, so how many young people do we have as members who are active? And then what are they actually doing? So we can measure this in every campaign. And because it's basically a tech company, a third of the people there write code, we're actually able to build things that count this in real time. And those of you who, for example, are on Slack, we've built plugins into Slack, and we're about to launch, I hope, for Do Something soon. Pointing at you, Tong, where we can track these numbers in real time all the time. On Crisis Text Line, on Slack, I have a channel, hashtag stats, that every 5 minutes automatically updates and tells us exactly how many crisis counselors are on the platform, how many supervisors, how many conversations are going on, and how many people are suicidal at that minute. So we have real-time data. We didn't really talk much about data, maybe.
Actually, I have a data question for you.
So. Is that a fair answer?
Okay. Yeah, thank you.
But since we're on crisis text line, could you take 60 seconds and just tell this audience and the folks at home how they can help you?
We really need crisis counselors. We're growing very, very quickly. And being a crisis counselor is a phenomenal way to be a volunteer because you can do it from home. You can do it from anywhere. And the training is fantastic. It's a 35-hour training that you can do in your jammies, and then you take a 4-hour shift once a week, and you're literally saving lives. It's a human connection between one person and another person, strangers, talking someone through one of the toughest moments, perhaps, of that other person's life. It's pretty beautiful.
And is it global?
Right now, it's just the United States. We're working on outside the U.S. That'll happen in 2016.
Bilingual? Multilingual?
No, right now it's just English. And we launched in Chicago and El Paso. And interesting, we saw 3 times the usage in El Paso as Chicago, and the kicker is we launched it only in English. So we're finding huge usage in Latin markets, but only offering it in English. And actually, we're finding that it's quite successful compared to phone because you're not embarrassed if your English isn't as good. You can take your time and sort of text something out. No one knows. It's pretty powerful that way.
Okay.
But yes, we would love people to apply to be crisis counselors. I will just tell you that from starting the application to getting on the platform, there's only about a 37% acceptance rate. It's hard to do this, so we don't take everybody.
Right. I'd like to ask a question that came across on the Twitter social media thing, and I think it kind of takes us back, cycles back for a minute, because the questioner is incredulous. They go, regarding businesses with double bottom lines, do you really think social and commercial objectives can't support and advance one another?
No, that's not what I said. What I said is those, thank you for asking that. There are lots of good businesses. There are lots of good businesses doing really good work. But they are not better than the not-for-profits who live in that space and that's all they do. And what is frustrating to me is the juxtaposition, the comparison of the two. If you wanna, if your values are that you wanna go make a lot of money and buy yourself a yacht while also making shoes, great. You can, and you're gonna distribute your shoes, that's great, you can do that. And that's awesome. I'm glad you're giving away shoes. But I like more the not-for-profit where nobody has a yacht and all of the money goes to the shoes for poor people. Does that make sense? Not naming any companies.
Let's ask the audience. Does that make sense? Show of hands, people. Okay, so about half of you think it makes sense and the other half have no sense. All right, so please.
Hi, my name is Karishma Bagani. I'm an undergraduate student studying drama. And my question was related to the non-for-profit and, you know, just this idea of funding. I actually come from Kenya, so I'm in the midst of a lot of problems, and I'm very passionate about a few myself, very interested in looking at, like, fundraising and whatnot. So if you want to make it a purely fundraising, oh, well, non-for-profit organization, in a bid to help others around you, how, what advice would you give in terms of fundraising and being able to create a continuous cycle of generating income to sustain the project?
I mean, this is how the not-for-profit sector has always worked. People think that creating these other revenue sources will sustain and change the sector. It just hasn't happened. Everybody has said, like, oh, do a subsidiary that makes, like, T-shirts or have some other part of the organization that has a business. It just hasn't worked. It's been a distraction for a lot of organizations that have tried to do this. Very few of them have actually brought in lots of money. And in all the time that they could have spent doing that, 81% of funding in the not-for-profit sector comes from individuals. It would make a lot of sense to spend that time fundraising off those wealthy individuals. There are more corporations who are awesome. I am not, you know, anti-capitalist. I think companies are great, and there are all these products and services that people will pay for. That's terrific. And I think we should give convince those companies to give more of their money away, in part because it helps them to do more cause marketing work. Terrific. Foundations, I'd love to see them move that 5% to way beyond 7%. They should all do what OSI is doing, and spend down. They should do what Atlantic Philanthropies is doing and spend down completely. That's how you really make a difference. So yeah, I don't think that the traditional model is so bad. And I think there are ways to innovate and make it better. I hope a lot of the smart people here in the audience will commit yourself to the not-for-profit sector and making it as strong as it can be.
Please.
Hi, I'm an undergraduate student here. I'm studying global public health and medical. I'm an undergraduate student here, and I'm studying global public health and medical anthropology. And I was just wondering, it sounds like you have a really diverse background, and you're doing the crisis hotline and stuff. And so I was just wondering, like, how do you cross into a space, even if you don't necessarily like have like a bunch of experience in that like sector? Is that like something that's like like, how do you navigate that, I guess, is my question.
I'm not a diverse at all. I'm 100% Jew. The only thing diverse about me is my father is a Republican and my mother is a Democrat, so I come from a mixed Jewish household. But diverse in terms of spaces that I've been in, yes. So, by the way, I hope you all appreciate how funny I am, because I think the assumption is that, thank you. I think the assumption is that people in the not-for-profit space were like grumpy and serious and ambitious all the time. Actually, there are a lot of very funny people in the not-for-profit space, which helps when you're going after funding. Where's the girl from Kenya? It helps if you have a sense of humor. You know what's been really great is when I did Dress for Success, I learned a ton about the welfare to work space, and it was fascinating. And then left and have been a Do Something for 12 years, and I feel like I know a lot now about millennials and about young people, and I learned to run a tech company, which is what Do Something is. And now I'm learning this entirely new space at Crisis Text Line. I'm learning all about mental health. I'm learning about the deaf and hard of hearing, because we did not plan on this, but they have found us as a great source of help, but also as a terrific way to volunteer, which is awesome. They're some of our best volunteers. I'm learning about veterans, who are also incredible. So
how is it navigating, like, from space to space?
Hard and fun and interesting, and nobody owns any of this stuff. We're all unicorns. No, everything is unique. Nobody owns this, and you shouldn't be afraid to be like, oh, I'm a Jewish girl from, you know, Hartford, but I want to do the welfare to work stuff. Do it. We need help, you know, everywhere, and everybody should do this stuff, and nobody owns any of these issues. And if someone out there is the purest expert on it, then this shit would have been solved already. So we need people who are hungry and who are not experts in it, or at least don't believe they're experts in it, so they ask pure of heart questions and say, like, why is this happening this way? Here's an example. Not an expert in the mental health space, totally new at this. We came to it and everybody told us that our crisis counselors should never use I statements. They should never say I, because that's what the research said, that's what hotlines have been doing forever. You never put yourself in the mix. So I was like, test that. So our chief data scientist was like, yeah, we're gonna test that. Turns out that if a crisis counselor sprinkles in an I statement, like, I feel that, or I had that happen to me once, or I know what you mean, that happened to a friend of mine, that the texter is like a gajillion times more comfortable and has, you've established trust, and they blurt everything out to you in like a stream of messages. It's really effective. We have to test these things. We have to ask obvious questions. So it's great that you're studying public health. I hope you ask so many questions of people with very fancy degrees and long pedigrees, questions that you think are obvious and that you feel a little bit silly asking. They need to be asked.
Thank you.
I see a...
Hello, I'm Paulina. I'm also from Colombia. I'm a second year MPA student at NYU Wagner. And I'm just curious, so my passion is bridging the gap, the inequality gap. And I'm a strong believer in the power of education, particularly higher education, and bridging that gap. And I'm actually working on a social venture for career access and career success in Colombia. And I'm curious, as you mentioned, that experience is totally overrated. I couldn't agree more with that. And at the same time, for instance, my time here at Wagner, I've really seen how skills can be trained to acquire skills. So mm-hmm. I'm curious, when you mentioned that the power of training, where do you see the role of education, and particularly higher education, in bridging that inequality gap?
So I asked who was an undergraduate and said, you should finish, especially, by the way, if you're a student of color, because people are going to be prejudiced and they're going to be discriminated against. So finish your degree, even if it means a predatory loan. Sorry. Skills, capabilities, attitude. Those are the three things that you have in any employee. Skills, in most jobs, they can be learned. You can gain that. Attitude, you either have or you don't. You asked about that before. You either have that hunger or you don't. Capabilities, you maybe have, you can also fake, as I said before. But skills are the one that you can learn. You can learn on a job, unless it's some kind of really technical thing. So I'm always amazed by how many students come to us as interns or even as employees from NYU even, and have studied entrepreneurship, have studied not-for-profit stuff, and cannot read a Form 990, or have no idea how to read a cash flow statement, let alone create one. You learn that on the job. I mean, I was a Ruth Tilden scholar here at NYU until I bailed, and at the law school, but I never learned any of that stuff. I didn't learn about, so I supposedly, I mean, I'm here in the law school, I didn't learn how you file to start a new not-for-profit or trademark not-for-profit IP. You learn that stuff on the job. So, and I think that the certification and the like, oh, you need to have this degree, has just been this false thing that has kept low-income people and people of color out of ranks for a very long time. And so we need to dispel those myths, because it's just going to hold people back. The sector where I'm really seeing it now, I had a conversation last night over dinner about this, is tech, where tech companies are saying, oh, but you don't have a CS degree. Well, with only 18% of all computer science students being female, as long as tech companies keep saying you need to have a computer science degree, women are not going to get those jobs, because there's a pipeline problem. So what we need to do is change the way people think about hiring and the way people value people. I value your heart. I value your hunger. You'll learn the skills on the job. I'm telling you, I would take her over anybody here with an advanced degree any day.
So,
yeah. Sorry.
I want to weigh in on the question, too, in the spirit of full disclosure. So I'm a lot older. I'm 67. And I have some successes in my track record and some failures. Dropped out of school as a senior, picked up a night degree, went to work. And so I'm in the bachelor's ignorance school. But I want to footnote this, because there's a little daylight between us. There's nothing I per se disagree with, but I do want to caution folks who are coming into the social enterprise space with just a good idea. Most of these ideas fail for lack of good management, not being able to read a budget, not being able to, there are skills that are helpful. Look, you learn them from great courses like the one I teach.
I never took your class, so maybe that's true.
This is what, yeah.
I think you learned that
from
Wagner.
Or from people like Deb Brand, who's sitting in this class. I don't think it's easy to learn them in school. But the point is, you need to go in with the humility to learn them on your first job. And the difference, in my view, is if you go to work for Silicon Valley company XYZ, and you screw up and the whole company goes bankrupt, who cares? We don't get another app, and maybe it takes a little longer for Uber to show up at our door. In the social enterprise field, when you screw up, people suffer. So your own standards of performance, however you learn those skills, should be higher, and you should be tougher on yourself. So we're not actually disagreeing, but I'm a little tired of people who just think another good idea is what we need. We got plenty of ideas. Anyway, okay, how are we doing on time? I want to make sure we have time for everybody. One more question, I think, right? Or two more. Well, I have a few more too, you know.
So I want to address the last two comments that were made about how, when we're talking about social enterprises, not for profit, even for profit, there are people that we are, or we can make assumptions that we're serving, but that are not at the table. As far as the innovators, as far as the CEOs, as far as the managers, or even the interns. And so, you know, I made the decision to get a graduate degree from NYU, even though I do feel that I fit into a lot of the categories, and I struggle in class having to hear how my peers sometimes talk about groups that I identify with. And so that's on me, right? And certainly,
on them.
Well, it's on me
as,
yes, fair. Okay. It's on us all. But I guess I'm trying to like get a question out here. I'm definitely going to be texting you later anyway. but I guess my question if you're going to put social in front of anything or not for something because you want to, you know, be a good person and do good, right? Those are things that we say. What should be your responsibility to the groups that you are essentially basing your success on? You can't be a successful founder of a literacy program unless you are working in communities where there are children in 2015 who go back, you know, 5-6 generations who cannot read in New York City. So what is your responsibility to learn from these communities and to bring these communities up with you? Because some of the things that we're trying to innovate, they don't need innovation. They just need us to bring these microphones here in this hall to Harlem. And we could do so much more. So I don't really know if that was a question.
This is why I say I'm frustrated about when people just want to start something and they are not passionate about a person. It's not the idea of leading something, it's that you really care about XYZ things. So each of the things that I've done, there was no plan to my career. I fell into Dress for Success because I was at school here. Washington Park looked very different at the time. And I couldn't believe all the students who I was here with were always like protesting and doing petitions because they wanted more faculty of color. And I was like, really? Because there are women of color living in Washington Square Park. And that's a little bit more concerning to me than whether or not my like contracts professor is a woman of color who's calling on me. Like it was very kind of self-serving activism I felt when I was here. And I think that's why I came up with the idea for Dress for Success while I was holding a check in my hands, because it was like the most tangible, immediate, human to human thing that came into my mind that I was drawn to. And so, and I learned more from that job than any of the other jobs that I've done, in part because I loved the community and I loved the people that I worked for. That's the other thing about being a public charity as opposed to a for-profit company, which is when you're a public charity, you are owned, you are there for the public good. I see right now at Do Something is I work for young people. I don't necessarily work, I mean, I guess I work for the board, but really it feels like I owe a duty to the young people who are our members, not to shareholders or to funders. That's who I work for. So my agreement with your point is when you start something or you work for something, you should care deeply about the people that you're working for. It should not ever be just a job in this space. You should live it. You said that, Gabe, you said that even in the introduction. You should be consumed by it because it should be that passionate to you. It should be that's what you care about. You should know it and live it. Otherwise, why the heck are you doing it? Because you're not making lots of money. So why else would you do this as a job? You should be working for a people, for a cause or an issue, not for a company or a job. Does that make sense?
So in my case, I do all my social enterprise work, broadly defined, is in the global south, right? So 10,000 years of gender and racial discrimination, economic discrimination, a lot of people they can't even find the economic ladder, right? I think the paradigm in my brain, though, is different, which is it's a partnership. It's a shared listening. It's a conversation, because you need both pieces of the puzzle, right? You need, to put it sort of in broad, stereotypic language, the resources and technologies and whatever the hell else I can bring to the table, humbly. But I'm not going to be able to work in any community that I'm interested in, which is why it's so important for everybody to step up. So I'm involved with a project in Kenya. Someone said they were from Kenya. The entire team, from CEO right down the bottom, is Kenyan, Swahili-speaking Kenyan folks. I can't go do what they do. I'm not going to get mistaken for a Kenyan. But they can't do what they're doing without the fact that we can do some things here that support them. And it's tricky. And let me tell you, it's not easy. And sometimes you stick your foot in your mouth, and sometimes things blow up in your face. But you can't quit. That's the one inexcusable option. Last question from this gentleman.
It's good to be last.
You asked a question. Okay, please, sir.
Hello, my name is Aziz. I think I wanted to offer a different perspective. I work with the Board of Education, teaching math in Brownsville in Brooklyn, New York. And I've been, for many years, doing a lot of studies on income inequality in this country and trying to understand it and, you know, get behind it. My background is in finance and economics and just trying to get to the bottom of it. And, you know, I think my recent trip, I recently spent the summer in Switzerland, in Europe. And I think one of the biggest things that I learned from the trip specifically was, you know, our mindsets as Americans. One of the biggest reasons why so many poor people are poor, and I guess it goes also to one of the reasons why the income inequality is so strong, is because it seems to me the ideology in America, everyone has this American dream. It's especially, I see it here in New York City, it seems so many people in New York is so self-centered and thinking about themselves or maybe their children. Versus in Switzerland, specifically where I was for the summer, it was more solidarity. They actually have villages that come together and vote by hand. Well, they have a direct democracy over there, but they will vote to raise taxes, because when you raise taxes and when you pay more for things, then you actually can pay real salaries for the employees at those companies. And a lot of the products there were made in Switzerland and not off-shell to China and Malaysia and Korea and Vietnam. The biggest thing, I think, in New York and America is we have to, in my opinion, stop waiting and, I guess, begging the rich to help the poor, because the only way we can change is when the poor help the poor. It's not about the money. We have plenty of other assets within the poor community. And when we start thinking about each other and stop thinking about us as individuals, is the only way we can bridge the gap and help each other and change this America. My opinion.
So this is a wonderful place to wrap up. What we've shared tonight, what Nancy has shared by her candor and her insights, is not just a social entrepreneur. Social entrepreneurship, however we'd like to think about it, for-profit, non-profit, is part of a long march of social movements towards justice. And that's the mission, is to find your piece of the puzzle. And that, to echo what this gentleman said, is a conversation about solidarity and what kind of society we want to live in. And the, to their ever-dying credit, what the nonprofit social enterprises are doing, and hopefully someday the for-profits will as well, is giving us better ideas of how we can work together in social solidarity towards a better and more just society. So thank you all for joining us on the journey. And Nancy's going to... Thank you. We're adjourning on the note that Nancy's going to be in the lobby in the back signing her books and giving poker lessons and counseling school dropouts. So thank you all.